Blackstone Audio presents HMS Marlborough Will Enter Harbour and Other Short Stories by Nicholas Monsarrat. This book is read by Simon Vance. Forward. These three short stories, dealing with differing aspects of love in wartime, were written at intervals during the past 2 years. It was my original intention to publish the second one, Leave Cancelled, as a separate volume, but my publishers disagreed for reasons concerned in varying degrees with production difficulties and professional caution. I dare say they were right. I must, however, remark that Leave Cancelled, published as a separate novel in America, dodged in and out of the bestsellers lists for more than 6 months, sold 60,000 copies, and earned in a Midwestern journal the singular heading, Britain's Slave to Sex. This proves something, though I'm not sure what. N.M. Book 1. HMS Marlborough Will Enter Harbour. Chapter 1. The sloop, Marlborough, 1,200 tons, complement 8 officers and 130 men, was torpedoed at dusk on the last day of 1942 while on independent passage from Iceland to the Clyde. She was on her way home for refit, and for the leave that went with it after a 14-month stretch of North Atlantic convoy escort with no break except for routine boiler cleaning. 3 weeks' leave to each watch. That had been the buzz going round the ship's company when they left Reykjavik after taking in the last convoy. But many of them never found out how much truth there was in that buzz, for the torpedo struck at the worst moment, with 2/3 of the ship's company having tea below decks, and when it exploded under the forward mess deck, at least 60 of them were killed outright. HMS Marlborough was an old ship, 17 years old, and she took the outrage as an old lady of breeding should. At the noise and jar of the explosion, a delicate shudder went all through her. Then, as her speed fell off, there was stillness, while she seemed to be making an effort to ignore the whole thing. And then, brought face to face with the fury of this mortal attack, gradually and disdainfully she conceded the victory. The deck plating of the forecastle buckled and sagged, pulled downwards by the weight of the anchors and cables. All this deck, indeed, crumpled as far as the 4-inch gun mounting, which toppled forwards until the gun muzzles were pointing foolishly to the sea. A big lurch tore loose many of the ammunition lockers and sent them cascading over the side. Until the way of her 16 knots fell off, there were crunching noises as successive bulkheads took the weight of water, butted at it for a moment, and then gave in. And thus, after a space, she lay, motionless, cruelly hit, 200 miles from home. So far it had been an affair of metal. Now swiftly it became an affair of men. From forward came muffled shouting, screaming, some of it, borne on the wind down the whole length of the ship to advertise the shambles buried below. The dazed guns crew from A gun, which had been directly over the explosion, climbed down from their sagging platform and drew off aft. There was a noise of trampling, running feet from all over the ship, along alleyways, up ladders leading from the untouched spaces aft, confused voices tossed to and fro by the wind called as men tried to find out how bad the damage was, what the orders were, whether their friends had been caught or not. On the upper deck, near the boats and at the foot of the bridge ladders, the clatter and slur of feet and voices reached its climax. In the few moments before a firm hand was taken, with every light in the ship out and only the shock of the explosion as a guide to what had happened, there was confusion, noisy and urgent. The paramount need to move quickly clashed with indecision and doubt as to where that move could best be made. The dusk, the rising sea, the bitterly cold wind, which carried an acrid smell in sharp, eddying puffs, were all part of this discordant aftermath. The iron trampling of those racing feet all over the ship bound it together, coordinating fear into a vast, uneasy whole. A spur for panic, if panic ever showed itself. It never did show itself. The first disciplined reaction, one of many such small reassurances, to reach the bridge was the quartermaster's voice, admirably matter-of-fact, coming up the wheelhouse voice pipe. "Gyro compass gone dead, sir." The midshipman, who shared the watch with the first lieutenant and was at that moment licking a lip split open on the edge of the glass dodger, looked round uncertainly, found he was the only officer on the bridge, and answered, "Very good, steer by magnetic," before he realized the futility of this automatic order. Then he jerked his head sideways, level with another voice pipe, the one leading to the captain's cabin, and called, "Captain, sir?" There was no answer. Probably the captain was on his way up already. God, suppose he'd been killed, though. The midshipman called again, "Captain, sir?" And a voice behind him said, "All right, mid, I heard it." He turned round to find the comforting bulk of the captain's duffel coat outlined against the dusk. It was not light enough to see the expression on his face, nor was there anything in the voice to give a clue to it. It did not occur to the midshipman to speculate about this in any case. For him, this was simply the captain, the man he had been waiting for, the man on whom every burden could now be squarely placed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.